I want to welcome everyone to the first hearing of the Military Personnel Subcommittee in the 115th Congress. I wish to congratulate the new and returning members of the subcommittee, and particularly congratulate our new ranking member, Congresswoman Jackie Speier, who is not here right now, of California. I look forward to working with each of you on the important issues facing this subcommittee. The purpose of today's hearing is to receive an overview of the Military Review Board agencies, the Board for Corrections of Military Records and Discharge Review Board provide extraordinary important services for our service members and veterans. These boards are charged with the difficult mission of correcting errors in and considering mitigating facts and removing injustices from our military records. They receive thousands of applications every year that request everything from name changes on personnel documents to discharge upgrades. Over the past several years, many have raised concerns regarding application processing, backlogs, and the approval rates for discharge upgrades. Many have also raised concerns about the treatment of applicants with PTSD or TBI who are seeking discharge upgrades based on mitigating medical facts in order to obtain essential behavioral health treatment. Congress has passed substantial legislation designed to help remedy some of these issues, and the services have continued to work to ensure that each applicant receives timely, full, and fair consideration for the case. I look forward to hearing whether these combined efforts have been effective and if any additional legislation may be beneficial. I'm also interested to hear from the witnesses about additional challenges they face in the timely processing of applications and what resources are needed to overcome these challenges. Finally, I look forward to hearing about ways to improve applicants' access to the boards by leveraging new technologies like video teleconferencing. Before I introduce our panel, let me offer the ranking member, Ms. Speier, which is Ms. Tsongas, an opportunity to make her opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And Ms. Speier would be here, but an Intelligence Committee briefing had not concluded that she had to stay to see through. And so I'm happy to be here in her behalf and read her opening statement. So thank you, Mr. Chairman, for convening this hearing today. And thank you to our witnesses for your testimony to the subcommittee. I don't envy you, as you probably have some of the most difficult jobs in the Pentagon, but also some of the most important. As a civil servant charged with ensuring that the service of our military members is fairly characterized and accurately reflected in their records, there are long-term consequences of your board's decisions. Not only financial consequences, although healthcare and education benefits do often hang in the balance, but more significantly, those decisions have the potential to make our veterans mentally whole and restore dignity and pride to them and their families. This is particularly true when we consider that only recently have we started to understand the possible behavioral consequences of post-traumatic stress disorder, traumatic brain injury, chronic traumatic encephalopathy, and military sexual trauma. We must make sure that the boards make every possible effort to take these factors into account when considering a request to upgrade discharge status. We need to ensure that mitigating conditions are taken into account. All too many service members feel that there is a stigma associated with a PTSD diagnosis and may be hesitant to take appropriate care and documentation, to seek appropriate care and documentation. All too many military sexual trauma or MST survivors, an estimated 80%, do not report their assault and suffer alone. Worst, many sexual assault survivors who received either an honorable or general discharge are also branded with a diagnosis of, quote, personality, unquote, or, quote, adjustment, unquote, disorders on their DD-2114, when in fact all that has happened is that they were sexually assaulted. These diagnoses, which have a limited basis in science, make it hard for survivors to find employment in the civilian world. One survivor told me, quote, "I feel like I have a scarlet letter on my chest." And while I am speaking here for Ms. Speier, I have certainly heard the same thing. Equitability is another factor that you all must consider. Thanks to your staffs for providing recent statistics on the rate of discharge upgrades, but I'm struck by some of the disparities I see, not just across services, but also across the different types of claims. To choose one metric, the evidence required to support MST claims seems to vary widely across services, with some requiring formal documentation that a survivor who chose not to report, and remember that is 80% of all survivors, may not be able to provide. There may be valid underlying reasons for these differences, but I'm sure we all agree that supporting survivors is our top priority. I look forward to learning more about the reasoning behind these differences today. Your jobs are also difficult because your organizations are frankly overwhelmed. Your caseload is enormous and the backlogs are stunning. That caseload will only expand. The President talks about spending billions to increase our military end strength, but that comes with the responsibility to make sure that each and every one of these new service members are taken care of on the back end of their military careers. Part of that task falls to you. So I hope we have a chance today about what we can talk today about what we can do to address that now. Specifically, I'd appreciate your views on achieving efficiencies through the consolidation of boards across the services. Thank you again, and I look forward to hearing your testimony.
Thank you, Ms. Tsongas. We are joined today by an outstanding panel. We will give each witness the opportunity to present his or her testimony, and each member an opportunity to question the witnesses. We would respectfully remind the witnesses to summarize to the greatest extent possible the high points of your written testimony in 5 minutes or less. Your written comments and statements will be made part of the hearing record. Let me welcome our panel. Ms. Francine Blackmon, Deputy Assistant Secretary of the Army for Review Boards. Mr. Robert Woods, Assistant General Counsel for the Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Manpower and Reserve Affairs, Mr. Mark Teske, Director of the Air Force Review Boards Agency. With that, Ms. Blackmon, you may make your opening statement, please.
Thank you, sir. Chairman Kaufman, ranking member, distinguished members of this committee, I thank you for the opportunity to appear before you on behalf of the Army Review Boards Agency. The Army Review Boards Agency provides the highest administrative level of review for personal actions taken at lower levels of the Army. The agency administers 13 boards, to include 3 statutory boards, the Board for Correction of Military Records, the Discharge Review Board, and the Grade Determination Review Board. The remaining boards are policy boards. The Army Review Board Agency staff consists of 112 civilian employees and 16 soldiers. In addition, 120 employees serve as volunteer board members for the Army Board for Correction of Military Records. These volunteers are senior civilian employees drawn from across the Army Secretariat and Army staff. The Army Review Board's agency administratively reviews and corrects service members' records involving impropriety, inequity, changes in policy and law, and even human error. The Army Review Board agency acts in the interest of justice, applying equity and compassion when considering the merits of an individual case. The agency processes approximately 22,000 cases annually. My vision is for the agency to be adaptable, cohesive, and collaborative team of highly qualified, responsive, and compassionate professionals. I expect them to be dedicated to customer service, transparency, justice and equity, and to carefully weigh the interest of soldiers, veterans, the Army, and the public. We strive to implement efficient and effective processes with the best technology available. We recognize that upgrading discharges is one of the most important functions of this agency. The Army has successfully implemented the Secretary of Defense's 2014 guidance to the Board for Correction of Military Records for requests to upgrade a veteran's discharge characterization where PTSD may have been a contributing factor. In those cases for veterans who claim PTSD, to include those who served before PTSD was a recognized diagnosis, boards give liberal consideration to evidence of PTSD symptoms in the service record or in a diagnosis provided by civilian providers. Moreover, special consideration is given to a Department of Veteran Affairs diagnosis of PTSD or PTSD-related conditions. To implement 2015 NDA requirements to enhance participation of behavioral health professionals on these boards, we have added neurologists, a psychiatrist, and three clinical psychologists to our medical advisor's office. Agency medical professionals provide in-person or written input for board consideration for each of these types of cases. Another type of invisible wound in which we liberally consider cases are those in which the applicant contends that they were victims of sexual assault while in the military. We recognize that many of these assaults were never reported to military law enforcement, meaning there is no corroborating police report for the board to consider. Because of this, in the last year, we have trained all agency personnel on markers of sexual trauma so that victims receive the most favorable possible outcome from their case. This training was provided by a renowned forensic psychologist and is in addition to the statutory requirement for advisory opinions for the Board of Correction Military Records and mental health professionals serving on the Discharge Review Board. We continually look for ways to better serve the soldiers, veterans, and family members who apply to one of our boards. To this end, 2 years ago, we made an agency policy change to hold cases open 90 days in order to secure corrections to deficient applications. Other changes included direct communications with applicants to clarify issues or request additional documentation to help their cases, as well as conducting periodic board member and agency staff training on current service policies and procedures. The men and women who serve our nation, along with their families, are our most important asset. The Army Review Board Agency is one of the ways we take care of our most important asset. I thank all of you for your continued support of our volunteer Army and the Army Review Board's agency. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Blackmon, for your testimony. Mr. Woods, you're now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Chairman Kaufman, ranking member, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. I'm Robert Woods, the Assistant General Counsel for Manpower and Reserve Affairs. As such, I'm the senior legal advisor to the Assistant Secretary of the Navy for Manpower and Reserve Affairs. And on behalf of the men and women of our various naval review boards, I thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today to have this overview of our review boards. Let me start by assuring you that the leadership of the Department of the Navy is committed to assisting our present and former sailors and Marines with fair and open processes in regard to the subjects presented to our boards, including those seeking corrections to their military service records, such as adjustments to their discharge characterization. Over the past few years, we've paid particular attention to petitions involving invisible wounds. We've conducted outreach sessions with veteran service organizations, provide professional training for our staffs, prioritize the processing of these cases, obtain medical review and input, and apply liberal consideration principles to ease the burdens of proof for the veterans. However, I do note that every petition is unique, and those involving the effects of service-connected sexual assault, post-traumatic stress disorder, traumatic brain injuries, or various mental health issues are among the most difficult and complex cases that we see at our review boards. We are keenly focused on the need for timely resolution of our petitions to our boards. As such, we're engaged in efforts to help streamline and modernize our processes. However, we also recognize that much of the time needed to properly adjudicate these petitions is related to the increased complexity and volume of the materials presented. Now, discharge upgrade petitions, including those seeking a change in the narrative reason for discharge and/or change in reenlistment codes, are adjudicated by our two primary boards, the Naval Discharge Review Board and our Board for Correction of Naval Records. These boards are established pursuant to specific statutory authority in Title 10. And in addition to these boards, we also have 7 non-statutory boards, including the Physical Evaluation Board, the Combat-Related Special Compensation Board, the Naval Complaints Review Board, the Naval Clemency and Parole Board, the Navy Department's Board of Decorations and Medals, the Disability Review Board, and the Personnel Security Board. Appeals Board. So with this brief introduction, I again appreciate the opportunity to present to you and am happy to address any questions you may have about our review boards. Thank you.
Mr. Teske, you're now recognized for 5 minutes.
Good morning, Chairman Kaufman, Ranking Member, distinguished members of the committee. On behalf of the men and women of the Air Force Review Boards Agency, thank you for the opportunity to appear today. With your permission, I am going to summarize my remarks and submit the complete statement for the record. As Director of the Review Boards Agency, I am responsible for the administration, oversight, and leadership of 10 appellate-level administrative review boards, 8 on behalf of the Secretary of the Air Force, and 2 on behalf of the Secretary of Defense. We receive approximately 15,000 cases annually from actively serving airmen, which include regular Air Force, Air Guard, Air Force Reserve, and civilian employees, veterans and their families. Our non-statutory Air Force boards adjudicate a wide variety of decisions on behalf of the Secretary of the Air Force. The Air Force Review Boards Agency strives to quickly and fairly adjudicate its cases, and we do so, and we are falling further behind. Over the past 10 years, our business has materially changed. 4 factors have significantly impacted the Air Force Review Boards Agency in both positive and negative ways. Our organizational transformation and modernization has solidified our processes, established metrics, and allowed us to leverage technology. Our increasing caseloads are increasing and more complex. We have resource constraints, and we have legislative and regulatory changes that we're continually implementing. In 2011, the Secretary of the Air Force directed the Air Force Review Boards Agency to begin an extensive transformation effort. Our transformation efforts were long overdue and created significant challenges because we did them while we continued to process cases. We did not compromise on quality or fairness, and we implemented these process improvements temporarily, sacrificing processing time in the near term with the aim of expanding our capacity and shortening processing time in the long term. We quickly realized the additional capacity generated by our process improvements was outpaced by an ever-increasing number of applications, and those applications were increasingly complex. We requested an Air Force manpower assessment in 2013, and that helped us determine that the agency was resourced appropriately. The assessment revealed significant human resource shortfalls, and budget for fiscal year 2018, we secured an additional 18 military enlisted billets to increase staffing levels. We continue to work on monitoring, improving our processes, and coordinating with the Air Force leadership to balance our requirements with other critical resource demands like readiness, training, sustainment, and modernization. In recent legislative and regulatory changes have also levied additional responsibilities on the boards. A perfect example is the emphasis on action on post-traumatic stress, traumatic brain injury, and sexual assault and similar injuries. The recent legislation required the discharge review boards and the boards for correction of military records to review and consider upgrading discharge characterization of veterans who experienced these conditions and were subsequently discharged with other than honorable discharges. Each of the 4 factors mentioned earlier place increased demands on our agency and its ability to provide prompt relief. We are doing all we can internally to secure the resources we need internally with the Air Force and to more effectively perform our statutory and regulatory duties. We are acutely aware that at the end of every one of our nearly 15,000 cases each year, there is an airman, a veteran, or a family member who is awaiting a decision. We are dedicated to these people and strive daily to provide fairness, equity, due process, and justice to all of our applicants. Mr. Chairman, I thank you again for the opportunity to appear before this committee and look forward to your questions.
Thank you. According to the Military Discharge Review Boards, the data from fiscal year 2016, the Army upgraded 36% of cases with PTSD or TBI. However, the Navy and the Air Force only upgraded 18% and 15% of cases with PTSD or TBI, respectively. Ms. Blackman, could you please provide an explanation as to what the Army is doing differently to ensure that men and women who served and were diagnosed with PTSD or TBI receive an upgraded discharge?
Sir, I will tell you, when we actually received Secretary of Defense Hagel's guidance in November 2014, one of the first things that we looked to do was to make sure that we had prioritized the cases. So in other words, they were not a part of the first in, first out. We were very careful to make sure that our mental health providers that actually set the case was very liberal in terms of looking at whether there was actually a nexus between the misconduct and the PTSD. And so in situations where we were looking at things like alcohol abuse or drug abuse, and the mental health providers had essentially come back and said, we do see a nexus, we were more liberal, if you will, in terms of upgrading those specific discharges.
Okay, thank you. Following up on my previous question, Mr. Woods and Mr. Teske, could you please explain why the percentage of cases you upgraded for those who claim PTSD or TBI are drastically lower than the United States Army's? Mr. Teske.
Thank you. We go back and we took a look at the numbers and scrubbed those numbers, and we don't have as many discharges that are characterized in an unfavorable light, number one. For instance, last year, Air Force-wide, we had 155 UOTHCs, and we had 43,000 discharges, roughly. So we don't have the numbers to deal with that the Army has as well.
Okay. Mr. Woods?
Yes, sir. I haven't seen any of the cases that the Army has given their upgrades to, nor have I seen the cases for the Air Force. I can only speak to what the Navy has done. And in implementing the same exact principles, which are those of liberal consideration, and trying to connect the dots between the condition of PTSD and the misconduct, these cases are dealt with on an individualized basis. And typically, those that are not upgraded are ones in which we've been unable to make that connection between the PTSD and the misconduct, or the misconduct was of a nature that it was either fairly severe or it was otherwise intentional or things of that nature. And so all I can say is that we review each of these cases individually. We spend a fair amount of time on each of them and labor on them intently. And so I don't really know that I can explain the differences, quite frankly.
Thank you. Following my previous question, it is my understanding that discharge review boards, DRBs are only located in the Washington, D.C. area, which means that many veterans would find it cost prohibitive to fly themselves, their attorneys, or their supporting witnesses to testify in person at a DRB. Can you please detail how each service is implementing, or at least testing, the use of video teleconferencing VTC technology? I believe this is an important technology that will allow more veterans to provide personal testimony to the discharge boards without physically being present. Ms. Blackman, why don't we start with you?
Sir, in November of last year, we actually reinstated our regional traveling panel. The first one was held in Atlanta, Georgia. We had potentially, I think there were 26 people that had signed up to actually participate. We actually received 19. We are looking to host our next panel in March over in Dallas, and we are looking to conduct these on a quarterly basis.
Thank you. Mr. Woods?
Yes, sir. Our discharge review board attempted to use video teleconferencing at one point, but we've run into a number of security-related struggles through our communication systems with the Navy. And so as an alternative, we've turned to telephonic interviews for personal appearances. And we've actually had quite a bit of success with them. We find that the petitioners appear to be somewhat more relaxed in their own environment.
Able so you want to a point of I just want to make sure that when you speak to telephonic, that's not VTC.
That's correct.
Oh, it is VTC?
It is not
VTC. Right. Okay, please.
Exactly. It's through just a normal telephone line.
Okay.
And we have a conversation with them and let them present any materials that they care to present and any arguments that they care to present. And we've had some very good success with that, both from the standpoint of having an increased rate of petitioners showing up to the actual personal appearance, whereas when we were having them in person, and we still do have some in person if folks are in the area or if they want to travel to here, they're certainly able to have an in-person one at the Washington Navy Yard. We do not have a traveling panel that goes around the country, and we found that the new telephone usage has really improved the capability of folks to come in and do their presentation, and they seem to be satisfied with that.
Mr. Teske?
Our discharge review board does do a traveling VTC.
Okay.
We do it at Robins Air Force Base in San Antonio, Texas, and then on the West Coast. We typically have one member of our discharge review board travel and set it up, and we hold it on a base. Part of that is to verify who's coming so that we know who they are. And the other challenge that we have is getting past our own firewalls. We are evaluating other technology approaches to try to use something like Skype or FaceTime, but that's in the evaluation stage.
So what would you, it would seem like Skype would be fairly simple and would have the same, be the same principle as a VTC. Well, I guess it wouldn't. You would, I think it would.
We have in our military networks, obviously with security concerns,
right,
we
okay,
have a problem getting past
that's
our
right.
firewalls.
Very,
that's
I
our challenge.
That. I understand that. Okay. Ms. Songas?
Thank you. I'd like to follow up on the issue of video VTC technologies and the use of that so that those who are seeking to have their characterization changed have that opportunity to make the personal story. And I'd sort of like to extend it to the BCMRs where they are not, that is not the case, where you're looking, where the right to make that statement personally doesn't exist. And so the issue of the VTC is sort of a follow-on issue. And I know that the Human Rights Watch has really been carefully considering the ways in which these decisions are being made, and I think a former staff member on one of the boards made the point to the Human Rights Watch the importance of a personal appearance at the DRB as being, quote, huge, and possibly, quote, the difference between getting an upgrade or not. So in that context, last September, there is here a Military Sexual Assault Prevention Caucus, and we hosted our second briefing on male military sexual assault. And at that briefing, we heard from Heath Phillips, a former sailor who was repeatedly raped and retaliated against by fellow sailors and his chain of command as well. Phillips eventually left his ship saying, quote, I couldn't take it no more, unquote. Phillips said, quote, I was not going to go out to sea with these men and deal with this every single day, unquote. So he agreed to an other than honorable discharge rather than facing a court-martial for going AWOL. And he said, quote, after being subjected to countless sexual assaults, beatings, threats, humiliation, in constant fear, a total basket case, I would have signed a deal with the devil himself to escape the torture I kept getting while on board the ship, unquote. And while the VA has found that he has PTSD that's 100% service-connected, he's still fighting after 20 years to get his discharge characterization upgraded. So he's told my staff, quote, that my strong belief is if I'm allowed a personal hearing and look them in the eyes and they could hear about my life and what I went through, the decision would not be denied. So again, in the context of the BCMRs, I'd just like to hear your thoughts on the feasibility of rethinking of affording petitioners who requested an opportunity to appear, and as you're considering the use of video technology, whether or not that might be permitted in, you know, that more narrow version might be permitted in the BCMR context, and we'll start here with you.
So, ma'am, as I had indicated, we do, within our discharge review boards, have the VTC capability. And so a situation as you had described, that would be certainly one that we would have had the traveling panels with the VTC equipment.
So even though it's in the BCMR context,
or
as
BCMR,
opposed to the—
So with the personal parents, typically we only do about two or three per year. With the Army, we're looking at a magnitude of about 14,000 cases that we adjudicate, you know, with a record review. And so those individuals that do feel that their stories are compelling, there is an opportunity to do a personal appearance.
And how do you make that decision? Since it's not a right, it's a discretionary decision on your part.
We essentially look at the records itself to say, is there insufficient evidence within the material that the applicant has provided? If we think there's information that is not there, that is lacking, and there's an opportunity to bring them in to get additional information, that would be one of the opportunities that we would look at to actually, you know, bring them in to say that we just don't have sufficient evidence with a records review.
So this is, this gentleman has obviously served in the Navy, and the Navy has a different approach. I welcome your thoughts.
Yes, ma'am, thank you. That's a tragic case, and I'm sorry to hear the suffering that he's going through. The problem with having the personal appearances at the Board for Correction and Naval Records is really one of resources and the magnitude of the number of cases that we deal with there. We actually haven't given consideration to perhaps having some type of a set aside for discharge review cases, because that's a smaller portion of our overall work requirement there. So that's something that we certainly could look at. But typically what happens when a person petitions and requests a personal hearing, they are asked what the purpose of that personal hearing is. What do they want to accomplish with that personal hearing? And in the few cases that I've seen where those have been requested, they really don't articulate the type of rationale that you just described. I think that rationale that he just gave would probably be compelling if it was articulated to the board. But as far as I know, I've not seen that type of an argument made to garner a personal hearing. And as I said, the magnitude of the caseload that we have at the board and the resources that we have, if we added a personal hearings, a considerable number of them anyway, it would really stall things out considerably, and we're already pretty much at maximum capacity. So I think that would be problematic, but we'd certainly be interested in considering it.
Well, we'll certainly go back and revisit this with this gentleman who, as I said, has come to speak before the Military Sexual Assault Prevention Caucus and follow on. But I do think, I can't imagine that he's alone in his story, and I do think even though it might be costly, we're talking about something that has a real impact on people's lives. I have one more question, if I could. Between 2000 and 2009, government reports reveal that thousands of service members were discharged improperly for a, quote, personality disorder, unquote, many of whom were rape victims. Though their discharges were usually honorable, the narrative reason for discharge on their discharge paper, DD-214, unfairly labels them as having a, quote, personality disorder, unquote. This is deeply stigmatizing and may prevent them from getting jobs or benefits. Brian Lewis, a survivor of male sexual assault who also has briefed the Military Sexual Assault Prevention Caucus, as well as testifying in front of the Senate Armed Services Committee, has said that as a result of his personality disorder diagnosis, he carries his, quote, discharge as an official and permanent symbol of shame on top of the trauma of the physical attack, the retaliation, and its aftermath, unquote. For veterans whose doctors confirm that they do not have a personality disorder, what prevents your offices from changing the narrative reason for discharge to the neutral, quote, secretarial authority, unquote, as was done after the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell for those who were discharged for their sexual orientation? And I'll start to the right here, since I kind of short-circuited you in the previous round.
So could you repeat the last part of the question, ma'am?
So, you know, for veterans whose doctors have confirmed that they do not have a personality disorder, what prevents your offices from changing the narrative reason for discharge to the more neutral, quote, secretarial authority, unquote, which was done after the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell for those who'd been discharged for their sexual orientation?
Nothing prevents us, and we have, our Board of Correction and Military Records has considered exactly the type of cases that you're talking about, and we have changed the narrative or the reason for discharge on the 214s. So we do that on Don't Ask, Don't Tell on a regular basis. We have done it on sexual assault, sexual trauma cases as well. So we do address that.
Do you have some sense of what the metrics are? How you, is it routine, automatic, or is it a complicated process?
So it's not a complicated process. Is it routine? We have a presumption, or we regularly consider the facts of the case, and then we make an assessment. And we go back and forth with the applicant as well. When we do they submit the case, we evaluate it, and then we provide our analysis back to the applicant to see if they have anything additional they want to add, because we try very hard to be transparent and fair. Then they get a chance to respond, and then there can be this back and forth a couple of times so that they have the opportunity to submit additional information to prove the case. But what I've found in reading the opinions of our board members is they are very generous, and they attempt to go out of their way to find a solution that is the right solution for the applicant. I've only been in the job since about December, so I'm the new person on the table. But what I've seen is our members are very honorable, and they're very considerate, and they really, really try to do the right thing.
That's good to hear. Mr. Woods?
Yes, ma'am. I think based on the factual pattern that you presented, I would find it to be highly unlikely that we wouldn't change not characterization necessarily, but the reason for discharge to secretarial determination. If the person presents medical evidence that refutes the original diagnostic, or even it might not have been a diagnostic, it may have just been simply an administrative determination of a personality disorder without a medical determination, that's entirely possible, especially back in the Vietnam era and later, before our more recent times, when we've become a little bit more aware of these kinds of situations. So we certainly have the capability of doing it, and especially if there's refuting medical evidence. And in all of these cases, we do have them reviewed by a medical practitioner to try to determine whether or not there's evidence that would suggest that, in fact, there may have been a personality disorder situation. But that's not a change that we would be particularly reluctant to make, quite frankly.
Do you have any sense of the numbers of the Air Force?
I'm sorry, I don't, but I'm happy to get those.
Actually, I'd ask a question for I'd like to ask that, yes. If you could get back to me.
I'll take that for the record. Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
And ma'am, I would say very much like the Air Force and the Navy, the Army as well, as long as we have the appropriate documentation, we routinely change the narrative to reflect secretariat authority.
Thank you all. Appreciate your testimony.
Thank you, Ms. Songus. The statistics for approved discharges, discharge upgrades, appear low. What is the most common reason these applications are disapproved? What can the review boards do to help improve the quality of these applications? And lastly, can you explain how you apply quote-unquote liberal consideration? Ms. Blackman, we'll start with you.
So, sir, in terms of the reasons that we routinely deny, it would be for cases where we see there is not a nexus. So, for instance, we had a situation with an individual that had documented PTSD. And so as we looked at the specific case, there were instances with drunken and disorderly conduct, which the mental health providers could determine that there was a nexus between that misconduct and PTSD. However, in the same vein, there were challenges where the same individual had stolen checks from a roommate of about $500, taken them to the American Express, cashed them, and basically was larceny and forgery. So at that particular instance, the mental health providers looked at it and said there was not a nexus between the misconduct and the PTSD. And so often we have cases that kind of mirror that. On the converse side of the house, we had a situation where there was an individual that came in that essentially said, you know, the Army separated me with a disability separation. I was a rape victim. She says, I think it should have been a disability retirement. Unfortunately, the perpetrator had individuals that could corroborate his story. But as we looked at the case, we kind of looked at the behavior of the applicant, and we could see that there was a downward spiral in behavior after this particular incident had happened. We saw the applicant had become indrawn, inward, sullen. And so with that, we said there has to be a nexus. And so with that, we basically took her from a 20% disability separation to a 60% disability retirement and paid her back pay to 2002.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Woods.
Yes, sir.
I'm sorry, Ms. Wagman. How do you, again, can you explain how you, do you feel like you've adequately explained liberal consideration,
exactly, because I think without that ability to say that it's black and white, we were looking at things that said there may not necessarily be the documentation there, but if you look at the markers per se, there were other things that existed where we considered it liberally as opposed to just a black and white case.
Okay. Mr. Woods.
Yes, sir. First, to the examples, we've provided a couple of examples in the written testimony, and I can summarize two of them that reflect both sides of the coin. The first was a Marine corporal who deployed in 2004 for Operation Iraqi Freedom, was suffering from PTSD as a result of that service. Engaged in a single incident of marijuana use, pop positive at some point, and ended up with a disciplinary action and an unfavorable discharge. That was a case that we took into the board, reviewed the facts, the fact that it was a one-time event, that it appeared relatively close after his return from the AOR, and the fact that he did have a recognized diagnosis of PTSD. We thought that it made sense that that was likely to have a causal connection, and as a result, we upgraded that particular discharge. On the other side of the coin, we had a Marine sergeant who had deployed twice, once in 2005 and the other in 2008, I believe, both for 6 months in support of Operation Iraqi Freedom. And after his return, he was engaged in some misconduct, illegal drug use in particular, and was actually scheduled for separation. But in light of his performance and his combat tours and things of that nature, they held his discharge in abeyance and said, we're going to hold this out there on the event that you're able to remain out of trouble for the next year. Unfortunately, 2 months later, he got in more trouble and was caught purloining copper gutters from a government building that were valued at about $15,000 and selling them downtown to a local salvage yard. And as a result of that, he was disciplined and set up for a discharge board before a board of officers where he was represented by counsel. That board of officers saw the evidence of the theft and, as a result, voted unanimously that he should have an under other than honorable conditions discharge. We couldn't find the connection there between the PTSD and the theft, and that was a case in which we did not grant relief. And so I don't want to say those are typical necessarily, but in a large sense they are, in that when we're talking about singular incidents of misconduct relatively connected to the combat service and or the PTSD issue, and then a discharge, those are cases in which we would be more likely to grant relief, whereas if you're engaged in some type of conduct that is of the nature I just described, or something along those lines, some type of intentional crime or harm that they did to someone, those are the cases in which we're going to be less likely. I think you asked a couple of other questions within there as well.
Sure.
Address those.
Yeah. Just one follow-up on the on the case that you just described. What was it? Was that? Do you recall if that was non-judicial punishment or did it receive summary special general court martial?
It appears that they took action via non-judicial punishment, sir.
They did. Okay.
Very good. In preparation for the discharge board.
Okay. Okay. What can the review boards do to help improve the quality of these applications?
Well, that's been part of our outreach program of late, and we've been reaching out to veteran service organizations. In fact, our Naval Discharge Review Board created a pamphlet, which I believe we've provided to your staffs, that describes the process, gives them insight as to how to proceed in presenting their case and their petition to the board. And so they've been distributing those pamphlets. We also have information on our websites. And in addition, when a petitioner files their appeal, if it appears to our folks that there's either insufficient evidence to support their package or we have some questions about it, there's a fair amount of back and forth between the staff and the petitioner.
Okay.
And so those are some of the ways that we attempt to help folks proceed in front of our boards.
Okay. Mr. Teske?
So, to start out with, I'll piggyback on what Mr. Woods was saying as far as how we're improving our process and how we're improving the applicant's ability to file claims or to file corrections. We do, just as Mr. Woods said, when we do get a application, we have a lot of back and forth between the applicant and our claims examiners, so that we can distill down what they need and what they can get. We also, at times, go to the record centers, go to the various sources of information on their behalf as well and request records. As part of our process, we also request advisories from the people who own the policies throughout the Air Force so that we can be further educated in our board. And we serve those advisories on the applicant as well, so they are aware of what's going on. We have a reading room so that they can research our past cases. We are looking, we've digitized our process. Yes.
Jessica, when you say reading room, of course, you're referring to
it's a virtual reading room.
Available online? Yes. Okay, very well.
Yes.
Okay.
And we also are, as part of our modernization, we're looking at trying to facilitate electronic submissions and electronic applications. But you know, we still have security issues when we're working through that. But we are trying to make this more accessible.
Okay.
So do you? And then I'll go on to the other.
Yeah.
Pardon me, sir.
Liberal consideration.
Okay. So liberal consideration. I can give you an example of where we use liberal consideration. First off, though, whenever we deal with liberal consideration in our discharge review board and our BCMR, we serve the secretaries. Review the Secretary's memo, the Secretary of Defense's memo on liberal consideration. We also have an Air Force, the Secretary of the Air Force, penned a memo on what liberal consideration means, and we give that to the members as well. So we reiterate that and we hammer that home. We also deal with that through training of our members. So then I'll give you an example of liberal consideration. We had a member who was an air controller over in Afghanistan, had a number of tours over there, got PTSD, was diagnosed over there, but he sought some self-medication and he got himself into trouble and he just shared some of the medication Xanax with some of his colleagues. He also, he was married, he committed adultery. As part of his discharge, he was originally proposed for a court-martial. He took an Article 15 and then he got under other than honorable conditions discharge. He applied to the discharge review board We gave liberal consideration to the PTSD and the nexus between that and the drugs and the adultery and the things that happened over in the theater, and we upgraded his discharge to a general under other than honorable conditions.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to now defer to the ranking member, Ms. Spear.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. And again, I apologize for the delay in my arriving, but as I think you've been told, I was in an important Intelligence Committee meeting. So one of the things that I'm concerned about is the fact that there's such desperate grants provided by the various services. And for instance, the Army granted upgrades for 4 out of 8 requests at 50%, the Air Force at 20%, and the Navy at 11%. And I would like to see it standardized, because I think for our military service members, they should all be treated the same. And I don't know that they're being treated the same, and I don't know that outside of conversations you may have with each other from time to time, whether they truly are being treated the same. So. Let me ask you, Mr. Woods, you have the lowest percentage, and in particular, as I look at MST, the others were at 50% and 20%, and you were at 11%. And I've talked to all of you privately and have asked for additional information, which I think will certainly inform our work as we move forward on this issue, but I'd like for you in particular, Mr. Woods, to comment.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I think that our dealings with these cases is such that I'm not sure how to suggest consistency across the three services, and I'm not sure there isn't consistency is the first point, because we've not really studied whether there is or there isn't. Obviously, the numbers would not reflect consistency, but given the nature of each individual case and the fact that they are determined individually based on the merits of those particular cases, in any given year or period, those numbers can certainly fluctuate. And I can't tell you that we aren't doing very similar things in the Navy boards as they are in the other services boards. I can
well, for instance, Mr. Teske, when he met with me, made a compelling case that in the Army, they bend over backwards, give the benefit of the doubt, go the extra mile. And I didn't hear that when you met with me. Right. So not that you can extract anything from conversations, and that's why we would like to look at the cases themselves.
Certainly.
Redacted, of course. But. It would seem to me that there would be great benefit for standard policies to be put in place that would, you know, guide your decision making, so that someone in the Navy who's making a request for an upgrade is treated the same way as someone in the Army.
Makes total sense to me as well, and I'm hopeful that we are doing the same types of standards, but I can't tell you for sure whether we are or we aren't.
Well, let's just look at military sexual trauma.
Sure.
50% grants in the Army and 11% grants in the Navy. Let me ask Mr. Teske, how do you evaluate these cases that you would have 50% of them being changed?
Well, I'm the Air Force, ma'am.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's all right, but I don't want to presume to speak for the Army. Then that
no,
would be misplaced.
And I misspoke, and I apologize, Ms. Mackman. I got your services. So let's go to you, Ms. Blackman.
Ma'am, as I had indicated earlier, when we initially got the PTSD guidance in November 14, that Secretary Hagel had sent out, I said, we also need to apply the same very liberal consideration for military sexual trauma. And so we started to do certain things like training. For instance, last November, we brought in a renowned psychologist by the name of David Lisak that trained the entire workforce on sexual assault and what did that mean. Not necessarily just because there wasn't a police report or a CID report, that there were other markers that the board and the workforce should be considering as they actually wrote the case. And so as they started to look at it, it wasn't just very a black and white situation where it is we have this documentation, or because there's a lack of documentation, we're going to deny it. It was more, how can we say that there are other things that are happening that could suppose sexual assault as opposed to, no, it did not happen. We also brought in a panel of sexual assault survivors that kind of talked to the workforce as well to say, as a result of that act, these were the things that manifested themselves within me as an individual and as a person. So that as our analysts were writing the record of proceedings, they had the ability to kind of understand the impact of what that meant and what was happening to the victim, if you will.
All right. With that background, Mr. Woods and Mr. Chesky, have you, for instance, brought in sexual assault survivors to have them explain to your board members the experience and ramifications?
To my knowledge, we have not brought in sexual assault survivors to do that. However, in response back in the December timeframe, this just past December, in some of our outreach efforts and then discussions with representatives from Human Rights Watch, and in taking into consideration a report that they issued, we got concerned that perhaps we weren't paying the type of attention to some of these cases as we need to. And as a result, we partnered with our Department of the Navy Sexual Assault Prevention and Response Office, and were able to have four of their subject matter experts, a medical doctor, a clinical psychologist, a trauma nurse, and a criminologist, take a look at the cases that we had done with regard to the sexual assault trauma over the past, give or take, two-year period, 15-16. And they reviewed approximately 86 cases in great detail with a view toward trying to determine whether or not we could establish some type of policy that would help us cognizant of the concerns and issues that presented in these types of cases, or as if we were missing something. And honestly, their review, they struggled in their review trying to connect the dots in the cases that we denied. They felt that the cases that we granted made a lot of sense. And what they recommended and what we're about to enter into is an agreement with them to use their expertise to gain advisory opinions. And we're even considering having one of their experts sit on any panel at the Board for Correction of Naval Records that would involve a claim of sexual assault.
Okay, we're going to be running out of time. So, Mr. Teske.
So this past January, we provided training to our Board of Correction Military Records, which all the panel members are volunteers. We had a panel come in for about 2 hours of
sexual assault survivors?
Not of survivors, but of mental health professionals and people who specialize in sexual assault to educate them on, as Ms. Blackman was saying, on some of the characteristics and markers and to provide that training. That's one. We also have our psychiatrists who are members of the board on those kind of cases for the Discharge Review Board. They provide advisories to the Board of Correction of Military Records on any situation where there is an allegation of sexual assault, sexual trauma. So we do go out of our way to make sure that our members are educated. And as a result of our training this past year, as well, we believe that more frequent engagement with our members on discussing these cases and bringing these issues up is required. And we're looking at probably doing kind of a 6-month check-in with everybody for about a half a day on some of these issues that we need to drive home.
So here's an area that I'm very concerned about. If you had the members of Congress who, when they left office, under whatever circumstances, had a similar ranking of honorable, general, or less than honorable. A lot of members would leave with less than honorable discharges because of their behavior here. Now, they leave and they go out and they continue with their lives and presumably get jobs and do well. I worry about the service members who have been labeled with a general discharge or less than honorable, and the likelihood of them ever getting employment. Now, I can tell you that there have been circumstances that I have seen where persons in civil society, who've committed felonies, can come back to the court subsequently and make the case that they have been upstanding citizens for a period of time and have those felonies reduced to misdemeanors, and then be much more likely to find employment. I really want us to think about whether or not we should create a mechanism within these boards that will allow individuals to come back subsequently after a period of years, make the case for their good behavior, and potentially have those discharge identifications upgraded. And that's more a comment than anything else, but hopefully we can talk further about that and maybe do something in the NDAA about that. I'd like to just spend a couple of minutes on VSOs. To what extent have you incorporated feedback or recommendations from VSOs? Ms. Blackman?
So, ma'am,
please, I think we're just, let's go forward with more questions, but please limit your responses a little quicker, please, if you could. Thank you.
Okay, sir. So, ma'am, we've had almost 100 engagements with military service, veteran service organizations, where it's an opportunity to provide them feedback on what we do and an opportunity for us to actually hear the things that we may not be doing that are so well. So we do have that interaction with them frequently.
Okay, Mr. Woods.
Likewise, we are engaged with the veteran service organizations quite a bit. As I've said before, we've created pamphlets for their use to distribute to those who are engaged in their organizations, and we've tried to educate them on our processes, and we're happy and continue to do so. I can't say that we've done 100, but we've done quite a few outreaches as well.
Have they made recommendations that you've embraced?
Other than some of the things that we've been doing, which is to better inform the petitioners of materials that they might consider being providing if they can to enhance their case. Also, to one of the things that we've done in the Board for Correction Naval Records is, in any case where we've denied relief, we provide a short explanation of why that relief was denied and what the record was lacking, such that if they feel that they can gather that information, they can come back and repetition for reconsideration of that decision. And so with new and material evidence, if they present that, then we do that. So we've tried to explain to them, instead of just getting a sheet of paper that essentially says denied, we've tried to educate them a little bit in that process at the end, if we haven't been able to do that on the front end.
Thank you. Mr. Teske.
So we have not had that kind of outreach and engagement with the VSOs. However, one of the things, as I came in December, we've been looking at how we're going to pursue outreach and education and communication plan. So that is one of the things we've been considering.
All right. So to the extent that they provide you with recommendations, would you also provide them to the committee so we'll have the benefit of knowing what they're looking for? Thank you. Mr. Chairman, I yield back.
Thank you, Ranking Member Spear. If we could just one remaining question and to all three of you. Do the boards have a feedback mechanism to inform the services of common personnel record errors you are seeing? Ms. Blackman?
I would have to take that for the record.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Woods? Mr. Teske?
I've talked with our personnel folks in A1 as well about setting that up, because we feel like there needs to be a feedback loop so that they can correct things before we have to fix them.
Okay.
So we're setting that up.
Okay, very good. Okay. I wish to thank the witnesses for their testimony this morning. This has been very informative. There being no further business, the subcommittee stands adjourned. Thank you very much.